Well, good morning. Again, good seeing everyone this morning. Are many of you familiar with the mite boxes from the Lutheran Women's Missionary League? I think a lot of you were there for the meeting on that Wednesday night. And so anyways, the story behind that is by the leftover change from the day or whatever's in your pocket as you clean out your pockets. Instead of just letting the change sit in the drawer, you can put them in my boxes. And this woman's mission project then gets collected amongst all the other Lutheran churches out there to do are to provide for service projects. And so sometimes it's for those who are in need. I know sometimes it helped a support towards my pastoral education. Or sometimes it'll go for just a particular missions project of that a church is putting on. I think there was some mentioning about, you know, making sure the homeless had showers and things like that. And so as all the churches are putting their change together, it's quite amazing what all these churches can do. So, yeah, Susan.
I'll help you out a little bit.
Yeah.
Every year the Women's Missionary League, they vote on projects, and then they set goals on how much money they're going to try to raise. So for the year, for the whole United States, their goal is $2 point something million. And the projects are people that want a project or whatever, they apply, and then their district, they vote on them, and then they meet the needs for those projects. And so it's a really good thing. And I have the little boxes out there on the table. And if you decide to do it, it'd be great. Just bring them back to us here, and we'll make sure that it gets up to Red Bluff to that church, and they can put it in.
Change.
Nickels, dimes, pennies, whatever you want to do.
When are you collecting the boxes?
I don't know. I think you could just bring them here, and we could put them in that closet in the kitchen.
Okay, anytime.
Yeah. You keep the paper towels. Or just tell me or give it to me or whatever, and I'll make sure it gets there.
Yeah.
But it's a lot of money. It goes to a lot of good things. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Well said, Susan. Thank you. Any other announcements for today? I think we're good to go forward. Let's go ahead and sing the hymn, Jesus Sinners Doth Receive. Please stand.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, will forgive our sins, and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
We pause to privately confess specific shortcomings to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean.
We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. Rejoice, for your sins are completely forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, our refuge and strength, the author of all godliness, hear the devout prayers of your church, especially in times of persecution, and grant that what we ask in faith we may obtain through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for the Old Testament reading.
Our Old Testament reading today comes from Genesis chapter 50. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs we did to him?" So they sent word to Joseph, saying, "Your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of the servants of God of your father." When this message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers then came and threw themselves down before him. "We are your slaves," they said. But Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is from Romans chapter 14. "Accept him whose faith is weak, without passing judgment on disputable matters. One man's faith allows him to eat everything, but another man, whose faith is weak, eats only vegetables. The man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not, and the man who does not eat everything and must not condemn the man who does, for God has accepted him. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And he who abstains does so to the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. For this reason, Christ died and returned to life, so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. You then, why do you judge your brother? Or why do you look down on your brother? For will we all stand before God's judgment seat? It is written, 'As surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will confess to God.' So then, each of us will give an account of himself to God." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 18th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times?" Jesus answered, "I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. The servant fell on his knees before him. 'Be patient with me,' he begged, 'and I will pay everything back.' The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. He grabbed him and begged him and began to choke him. "Pay back what you owe me," he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, "Be patient with me. I will pay you back." But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. "You wicked servant," he said, "I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?" In anger, his master turned him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. This is how my Heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother in your heart. This is the gospel of the Lord. Together we confess our Christian faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we sing the hymn, "Lord, Help Us Walk Your Servant Way." Hear the words from Romans chapter 14, the first verse. As for the one who is weak in faith, welcome him, but not to quarrel over opinions. So then, let me ask you, who would you describe as someone who is weak in faith? Is it someone who doesn't go to church? Someone who doesn't feel comfortable about talking about their Christian faith? Is it just anyone new or young in their Christian faith? As I think about just who might be those who are considered weak in faith, I'd imagine it depends much on who you would ask. When I researched this topic on Monday and wrote this sermon on that same day, there were a lot of comments about those who were weak in faith. Now, when I was first thinking about those who are weak in faith, I was thinking that this would, of course, be the youth who are learning how to engage in this world. I'd imagine many of you may have thought the same thing. The youth have a lot to learn. The Christian youth ought to learn just the depth of who God is and the depth of his goodness and love. They need to learn how to let their Christian values be a moral compass to their life in the midst of this corrupt world that we live in. But then after my research, I received one view from one young adult who was using their critical thinking skills and said, if older Christians are often so think they're so strong in their Christian faith, then why are there so many of them who are opposed to trying something new? Trying something new in their creative way of expressing their faith. New and seeking out ways to make new friends and to find new people. To be a living Christian testimony and be a living example of Christ. And then so we have to ask, for many longtime Christians, how many of them have sought to sit down with someone different than you and listen to their story? Listen to what excites them and try to understand it. I also read an interesting article that talked about how ministering to Native Americans in America during the 19th century had overall benefited from the Christian faith. The selling point or attractive reason for the people to become a part of the Christian faith was that Christianity made people more civilized and educated. It made people more sympathetic and more caring for others. The people had more of a self-denying and helpful heart with the Christian faith. And the people learned how to be more moral and happier than ever before. And yet, while these things happened to the Christian people, the outsiders of the Christian community also saw that people in the Christian community did many brainless and heartless things. For example, they occasionally found someone who would harm another person just because. In summary, the article said that the Christian teachings were needed for those inside the Christian community just as much as for those who were outside the Christian community. How we treat others matters. As for both Christians and those who aren't Christians, they are both watching us. People are watching how we live our lives and are seeing if we are a living example of Christ. Now, a mature Christian knows that, Christian or not, we are all corrupt people. Baptized or not, we all have our sinful nature that we just can't seem to shake off, which leads us to do stupid and unloving things. But because we have been baptized into the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, our souls are not only saved with our sins being forgiven, and we are not only brought into God's family, we also have the Holy Spirit to guide us to do what is right, to seek what is good, not only for ourselves, but also for others around us. The Holy Spirit leads us to things that bring joy for all people. Our epistle lesson talks about some interesting things. Some things that we might wonder why the Apostle Paul put them there in the first place. As Paul is writing this letter, and as he's getting to the end of it, I'd imagine there are some little things that just isn't sitting right with him. Some things in the congregation of Rome. Some things that seem to be a cross-cultural issue. He mostly talks about how to eat food with those who are weak in faith. What many believe is going on is that as the first century church is gathering together and worshiping together and eating together, there seems to be a conflict in knowing the best practices of eating. Eating among a group of believers both new and not so new. The Jews had their strict dietary practices that they've had for centuries upon centuries. And then Jesus comes in and eventually says that all food is now clean. Those strict dietary practices are no longer needed. So now you have Christians ready to joyfully eat anything that they want, like a good ham. And then you have Jews who are just learning about who Jesus is, and it's been burned into their conscience that a good God-fearing person will keep to the strict Jewish dietary rules. Now, the Christians who are ready to eat some good tasting food, could tell the new Christians to get over themselves because of what Jesus had said. Or they could say that they respect where they are at in their walk with God, and because eating all foods is not, they are not ready yet in their heart, that they'll have a traditional Jewish meal. However, the new converts from Jews and Christianity probably weren't the only issue that Paul is talking about. For the Jewish diet didn't have a vegetable-only diet. And yet our text for today talks about those who are weak in faith and only eating vegetables. Some believe that the Gentiles who were also being brought into the community had strict diets as well. And today people have their preferred diets, don't they? As the book of Ecclesiastes says, there is nothing new under the sun. Well, Paul seems to be saying that there are some strong Christians sharing their opinions with those who are new to the faith, as if they were supposed to just do as they say, especially when it came time for eating. And I'm thinking, how can you fault them for doing so? They are excited about their faith. They are excited about eating. Why are they having to step back and be considerate of other people's diets? And the main question Paul is really asking is, how are you using your Christian freedom? Are we using our Christian freedom to just please ourselves? Or are we living to please and help others? Are we living to build up our own kingdom? Or are we living to build up God's kingdom? Paul mentions here that what we do with our own personal preferences and how we seek to live the good life is ultimately between us and God. It's between the individual and God. For God will judge us when our judgment day comes. But as for us judging others, unless it's going to harm others or cause anyone's salvation to be at stake, there is no need to correct them. There is no salvation in dietary plans. And the scripture says there is no salvation in picking our holidays and picking which days we want to give thanks and worship the Lord. An issue for this time was, should we worship on Saturday or Sunday, the day that the Lord rose from the grave? Paul is saying here, you guys choose. But you guys choose in a way that helps those who are weak in the Christian faith to become strong. Now, these concerns might be rather insignificant for today, but I can imagine the cross-cultural issues of today in our community, if there would be any, would be figuring out ways of how to include those of a younger age, more so than the issues of race or gender. As Christians, we have to use our Christian freedom to communicate to others how God cares for them. People want to know first how much those around them care for them before they care about what you know. And what I read from today's scriptures is a reminder that we ought to try to embrace our Christian freedom to lead others to have a strong faith in Christ. For though we are not the children of Abraham by our own blood, his chosen people, Jesus has brought us Gentiles into his family just because he loves us. In our gospel lesson, we are reminded to forgive others because God has forgiven us. And our Old Testament lesson tells us that no matter how difficult or ugly our past gets, God can still use his people to do great things and have a bright future with a forgiving heart. The happier, blessed, and promising future is what our scriptures are talking about. A future living in forgiveness with all people, a future without holding grudges. For the promises of salvation in Jesus Christ is for all people. It's for all people to live as repentant sinners, living in God's love, living in God's forgiveness, knowing that the only reason why we are getting into heaven is because of what Jesus has done for us, has done for you, and done for me. He died on the cross while we were goofy and sinful, so that we could have a future in his righteousness and his good work, and not our own. And we look forward to that day when God calls us to his eternal home, when our bodies will be resurrected like Christ's resurrected body, and our broken and sinful natures will be no more. And we will forever enjoy each other's company, no longer owing anyone to anything, as we worship the Lord, giving thanks and praising him for eternity. In Jesus' name, amen. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. At this time, we now collect our offering. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, in your mercy, you have forgiven our unfathomable debt of sin, ransoming us with the death of your Son. Free us from our grudges and unforgiving nature, lest through our lack of mercy we exclude ourselves from your forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Almighty God, as you kept Joseph from evil, deliver us by your grace, so that we may learn patience in trials. Teach us to be slow to judge, quick to forgive, and steadfast in love for you and for one another. Lord, in your mercy.
giving Lord. All good things come from you. Open our hearts to be generous with the poor and to bring you the tithes and offerings you are due, and that your church and all her agencies may serve you and for your gracious purpose, and suffer no lack of people or resources to do the work of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Father, we pray that we may be patient with those who are spiritually weak, knowing that we also can miss the point of what's important when interacting with others. Let all that we say and do be representing your loving heart through the power of the Holy Spirit, so that all people we meet may know and be blessed by your saving word. Lord, in your mercy. God of power and might, sustain the nations of the earth and lead them in the way of justice and truth. Defend life and liberty and give us honest and faithful rulers, that our nation may strive toward what is honorable, true, and just. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, according to your will, grant healing to the sick and to the weak, especially those we now name silently in our hearts. Grant them patience to endure their time of suffering and crown their days with your mercy. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Almighty God, continue to give us fair and seasonable weather. Let the farmers receive the weather they need for an excellent harvest from their crop this year. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Hear us, Heavenly Father, for the sake of Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May you now leave with this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace.
Amen.
Amen. We sing with the song that's on the screen or in your insert.